Now we're there. Hello, high achievers. Okay, yes, well, it was there, right? Okay, let's get started. We're going only on YouTube today. No simultaneous transmission to Instagram. And this is the C2 Proficiency crew getting together to bring you news of Cambridge and of the exams, how things are going to be handled from now on. So before we start our presentation about writing, what is the name again, Salvo? He's the one going to present.
Advice for Cambridge CP.
Yes. Before we start Salvatore Novello's writing advice for Cambridge CPE, I would just like to say that we have been away for 2 weeks because your teacher got really sick. That's me, right? I got really sick and I had to recover, but now I am ready to come back, feeling normal again. And we're going to go live every week. However, we're going to change dates. It's not necessarily going to be every Monday, but I will let you know when it's going to happen, okay? We'll get ready for you. This is our CPE crew of English lovers. We get together on a weekly basis to talk about Cambridge. And one of the things that we were worried about was, when is Cambridge coming back? And is it coming back with changes? We had no idea if Cambridge was going to reopen with changes, and then we would have to relearn something about the exams before taking them. However, we know that Cambridge has decided to reopen in some countries. It is doing it little by little, and no changes came with this quarantine moment, right? It is still the same. The exams are the same. So everything that you had been studying and everything that you had been using to prepare for your Cambridge exams should be still the same, okay? You just continue doing what you were doing and you were going to be fine. We don't know when it's going to reopen in each and every country. It depends on government policy. However, you should pay attention to your exam centers in your specific country to see if they're ready to reopen, if they're ready to start retesting people. Definitely here in Brazil, we're not ready for it yet, but one day we will be, right? I don't know in Spain, how are things in Spain, Marta? Do you think Cambridge is reopening there soon?
I'm in the Northwest, I'm in Galicia. So for me, our checks around Coruña and Lugo, although there is a C2 exam in July, which is a paper-based one. They do have a warning saying that it's like, well, depending, I suppose, on the uptake of students going for it, it might get postponed as well. So they do give you a warning saying that it's likely to be postponed, or they'll offer you a different date at a different time of year.
Okay.
But that's fine, because I think Sylvia asked me earlier. She's like, "No, when are you gonna, you know, when are you going to go for it?" Because it's very difficult in Italy, and I just want to know whether it's the same in Spain. I said, "Well, I think no time soon, anyway. I mean, we are now in June. July is only less than, you know, a month away. So if they say give you a warning, then it's like it's unlikely. It's highly unlikely."
Okay.
Might be December. I think the next scheduled exam is in December.
Hmm. Yes. I have no clue when they're going to reopen here in Brazil, but since our governors and since our government is really open to reinstating normality, maybe we could have them back in November. But I don't know if Cambridge would bring people from abroad. I think we would just deal with our own examiners from inside. Okay, guys. So Salvatore Novello has prepared a really interesting explanation with writing tips for Cambridge proficiency exam. I'm going to pass the ball to him right now. I will ask everybody to please close your cameras and your microphones. And if you are watching this lesson here on YouTube and you would like more people to receive our information, please let YouTube know that this is interesting for you by giving us a like and pressing that little bell and sharing this with your friends. Okay? All right, guys, let's leave it to Salvo. Salvo, you have the spotlight.
Thanks, Flavia. So I think many students that are studying for Cambridge proficiency are a bit worried about one of the part of the Cambridge proficiency exam, the writing part, because this skill is sometimes overlooked. So in this step-by-step tutorial, I'm going to give some basic advice for C2 students. Part three of the Cambridge proficiency writing paper is the review. A review may be about a book, a magazine, a film, a play, a concert, but it may also be about, for example, an exhibition. The target reader is specified in the question, so the candidate knows not only what register is appropriate, but also has an idea about the kind of information to include. A review does not merely require a general description of, for example, an event or publication, but it specifies the particular aspects to be considered. For example, the review may employ narrative, as well as descriptive and evaluative language, and a range of vocabulary relating, for example, to literature and the media such as cinema or TV. In order to become familiar with what is required of a review, students should read and discuss a range of reviews, such as those which can be found in various magazines and newspapers. The language appropriate to a review will include, for example, language for describing, narrating, and evaluating. A student should try to extend their vocabulary to include what is related to literature and to the media. This is what is expected in part three, the review. The other part are the essay, in which you have to summarize the main point of two small extracts that see two different opinion or shades of a big subject. But another part, instead of the review, you can choose the article, the letter, the report. Today, I'm showing you the review. For example, in the task in part three, this is an example of what can be asked to you in the real exam. A newspaper is running a special feature in its books and media section about film and literature that might appeal to both men and women. You have been asked to write a review of a novel for this section. Write your review, 280 to 320 words, explaining why the book might appeal to both male and female readers and saying whether you would recommend it. It's important to cover all points in the writing, so read the extraction carefully, create a concept map, organize it in around 5 paragraphs. Mind your British English. So demonstrate a wide range of vocabulary, of grammar, of English. This is an example of what I wrote in Brighten Improve. In one of the previous session, this group of English lovers explained you how to use Brighten Improve. In particular, my fellow English lover, Andrew Lopez. Brighten Improve is a useful platform by Cambridge Assessment English, Cambridge English Assessment, and is very, very useful. There I wrote this review. I wrote about The Day of the Triffids. That is one book that I have here with me somewhere. Is a book that I'm reading. So The Day of the Triffids, it was written by John Wyndham in 1951, narrates the catastrophe of a world packed with carnivorous plant, ready to make people blind. This book could be read by a variegated public of both men and women who is fascinated by the horror genre in general. Perfect for someone who loves science fiction and stories of aliens, it does not include them in the plot. I will say that the novel is a horror fantasy fiction or catastrophe novel, scary in several pages of it. I would not recommend it for the easily affected. I continue in writing. Bill Mazen, the protagonist, is a triffologist. People that has been blinded by triffids are organized into mobs, imperiling the protagonist couple. There are two pivotal enemies, the triffids and the people blinded by them. The sighted individual plan to leave London. The theme of survival is omnipresent. To keep themselves alive, several kinds of alliances and social orders are experimented. Our hero escapes to the Isle of Wight with his wife at the end of the tale. I continued writing. Some of the reason why the book is notorious among a large public and has captivated readers for over half a century is that it is based on an original horror futuristic setting. It includes a selected English vocabulary. It is of highly emotional intensity. It uses a rare English spoken in 1950s. I would definitely say that after reading it, both men and women will have explored a fantastic series of fictional events full of love, fears, reflection on the social order, and on the capacity of humankind to face hardness. Not only would I recommend Wyndham manuscript, but I would advise everyone to have a copy of it in their shelves. Such a memorable tale for men and women to read. But last but not least, there is initial extremely negative feelings leading to a final happy ending of love and redemption. Yes, there is a happy ending. They go to the Isle of Wight at the end. This is what I wrote. And in Brighten Improve, with this, I got a C2 plus. A C2 plus in the platform. I would like to say to you more about English, the language of of any Cambridge exam. English is spoken all over the world as a lingua franca and in many regional varieties. However, British academic English should be considered the archetype for the C2, Cambridge proficiency. You will be evaluated by the way you write in the criteria of content, communication achievement, organization of tests, language, grammar, and vocabulary. But what is academic English? You may be confident in using English in everyday situation, but the kind of English you need to study is rather different. It is what is known as academic English and is the type of English you need for reading and understanding your study materials, writing about your subject, Academic English is different from everyday spoken English. It may use to describe an object or situation, describe a process or how something works, explain something. Much of academic English is about expressing the relationship between ideas. Although the language might be more complex than in everyday English, good academic writers aim to be as clear, precise, and simple as possible. They think about what their readers know already and aim to guide them towards less familiar areas and topics. The ability to write in academic style is something you develop as part of your university study. It is difficult to give overall rules on the way to write in a university course, as academic subjects vary in their vocabulary and expression, the type of text used, for instance, essays, reports, research articles, or summaries, how these texts are structured and organized. The main features. It is usually formal in tone and impersonal in style. Avoids contraction or shortened forms or verbs, such as won't, doesn't, on its. Avoids using a linking word, such as and or but, at the beginning of a sentence. Avoids personal pronouns. Yes, it's important to avoid I, me, you, your, because you are writing facts, not opinions. And may use the passive form of verbs. Avoids verbs that are composed of multiple words, such as give up, put up with. Tends to employ a cautious way of explaining findings, using expressions such as may, is it possible that, could. May use a specialized vocabulary. A curiosity. Do you know that the old English phrase meaning God be with you became the farewell expression goodbye? Do you know that a pangram includes each letter of the English alphabet? For example, the five boxing wizards jump quickly includes every letter of the English alphabet. I would like to talk to you a bit, to talk with you a little bit about English, British English. As with English around the world, the English language, as used in the United Kingdom, is governed by convention rather than formal code. There is no body equivalent to the Académie Française or the Real Academia Española. Dictionaries, for example, Oxford English Dictionary, Longman Dictionary of Contemporary English, Chambers Dictionary, Collins Dictionary, record usage rather than attempting to prescribe it. In addition, vocabulary and usage change with time. Words are freely borrowed from other languages and other strains of English, and neologisms are frequent. For historical reasons, dating back to the rise of London in the 9th century, the form of language spoken in London and the East Midlands became standard English within the court and ultimately became the basis for general accepted use in the law, government, literature, and education in Britain. The standardization of British English is thought to be from both dialect leveling and a thought of social superiority. Take with a pinch of salt what I'm saying to you, because speaking in the standard dialect created class distinctions. Those who did not speak the standard English would be considered of a lesser class of social status and often discounted or considered of a low intelligence. I don't want to say that anyone that don't speak standard English is stupid, but sometimes is a prejudice in the UK. Another contribution to the standardization of British English was the introduction of the printing press to England in the mid-15th century. In doing so, William Caxton enabled a common language and spelling to be dispersed among the entirety of England at a much faster rate. Samuel Johnson, A Dictionary of the English Language, was a large step in the English language spelling reform, where the purification of language focused on the standardizing both speech and spelling. By the early 20th century, British authors had produced numerous books intended as guides to English grammar and usage, few of which achieved sufficient acclaim to have remained in print for long periods and to have been reissued in new edition after some decades. These include, most notably of all, Fowler's Modern English Usage, is a classic, and The Complete Plain Words by Sir Ernest Gower. Detailed guidance on many aspects of British English for publication is included in Style Guide, issued by various publishers, including The Times newspaper, the Oxford University Press, and the Cambridge University Press. The Oxford University Press guideline were originally drafted as a single broadsheet page by Horace R.T. Hart and were at the time, 1893, the first guide of their type of in English. They were gradually expanded and eventually published first as Hart's rules and in 2002 as part of the Oxford Manual of Style, comparable in authority and stature to the Chicago Manual of Style for published American English and Oxford Manual. The Oxford Manual is a fairly exhaustive standard for published in British English that writers can turn into in the absence of specific guidance from their publisher house. So bright, clear, logical, understandable in standard English. You can use style guides by the Times, Oxford University Press, Cambridge University Press. Now, some practical advice. There are three main mistakes when you are writing and the data of the exam. Of course, you will be emotionally a bit unstable or emotionally vulnerable or a bit anxious, scared, performance anxiety. And it's even easier to do mistake on the day of the exam than beforehand. Common mistake number one, to write about something completely different from the subject, so something irrelevant, and from what it is required by the instructions. So you write about something else, you don't read the instruction, and you write something that is about something else. The solution: read the instruction carefully. Take time to plan accurately. Write exactly about the specific subject. Review what you have written before delivering the final work. Common mistake number two: narrow range of cohesive devices and organizational patterns without flexibility. Not using the conventions of the communicative task with sufficient command and flexibility. If you write with a narrow range of cohesive devices, or you don't organize the text with flexibility, you are not a C2 speaker and of course writer of the English language. The solution: to communicate in a better writing with sufficient command and flexibility is to extend the range of cohesive devices and flexible organizational patterns. Do your own practice, find your own method, or subscribe to a course. Communicates complex ideas in an effective and convincing way with a C2 language, which is flexible in respecting written review conventions. write effectively with convention. Common mistake number three, wrong preposition after a verb. In language, you can make several kinds of mistakes. One is the wrong preposition after a verb. For example, the listening text consists in four parts. Do you think it's correct? No, it's not correct. The listening text consists of four parts. Or otherwise, the loan interest depends off the starting date. When you write very quickly, possibly you can write the loan interest depends off the starting date. No. It's the loan interest depends on the starting date. Solution to common mistake number three, wrong preposition. Practice the use of English in regards to verbs in complex sentences. Practice as many phrasal verbs as you can, even if you don't use so much phrasal verbs in formal writing. Think twice every time you use a verb plus a preposition in your writing. A final advice on they say, not the review, but they say, support your point in the body of the writing, the introduction, the body in which you support your point in a clear logical order. Explain them fully, develop logically and fully. Provide examples. This is what is about. It's what the writing exam is about. Support your point, explain them fully, provide examples. Good luck. Good luck, really. I hope that you will proceed with your studies. I hope that you will sit the exam as soon as is resumed by Cambridge English assessment, because now we have this COVID disruption. Good luck on the day of your exam. I'm sure we will see again every Monday with Flavia Costa, and I hope you will use these tips to prepare for the Cambridge proficiency writing task. In order to know more about me, go to English. I have a YouTube channel, a Twitter account, and a Facebook page. Go to my YouTube channel, in which I prepare students for B1 writing, in this address that you can copy. Or my Twitter page, twitter.com/easy-to-remember-english-latest, twitter.com/english-latest, or my Facebook page, facebook.com/inglese-italia, that means English Italy, Inglese Italia, INGLESEITALIA, is my Facebook page. Thanks again. Back to Flavia. Thanks, Flavia.
Thank you, Salvatore Novello. I didn't introduce him properly enough. He's an English teacher from Italy. His channels are there. I'm going to link them down here to my channel as well, so you can find him easily if you need a teacher to guide you through English exams online. He is also a really good online teacher. He knows how to deal with all of this online environment.
You can also suggest me to someone at a lower level, for example.
Okay. All right. So this was Salvatore Novello with his writing tips. Thank you very much for watching, and we will see you next Monday. All right. So